Hi, I'm John Iredale, Pro Vice-Chancellor for Health and Life Sciences here at the University of Bristol. In our last podcast, I spoke to Professor Adam Finn to discuss the phenomenal achievements of the research community in developing several safe and effective COVID-19 vaccines. Indeed, we had our discussion the day before the first individual was vaccinated with the Pfizer vaccine. Since that conversation, two more vaccines, the Oxford-AstraZeneca vaccine and the Moderna vaccine, have received approval for use in the UK by the MHRA. So the COVID vaccination programme is now in full swing. The government aims to offer a first vaccine to everyone in the most vulnerable groups by mid-February. But alongside fantastic progress in the battle against COVID-19, we're also seeing a new, even more infectious strain of the virus emerging, both in the UK and elsewhere in the world. So given these pivotal developments, I'm delighted that once again, Adam has been able to take some time out of his busy schedule to give us an assessment of the situation as he sees it. So Adam, welcome back.
Hi, John, nice to be with you.
So just to kick things off, how confident can we be that the vaccines that we now have provide protection against the new strains of the COVID that have been identified? People talk about the UK or Kent variants or the South African variant and latterly the Brazil variant. And is there a risk that vaccine resistant strains could emerge?
Well, the answer is that we can't be completely confident. The evidence that we've got so far is that at least for the variant that we're seeing in the UK, the Kent variant or B1.1.7, that the vaccines that we've got do work and continue to work, and that cross-comparing convalescent sera from people infected with the original Wuhan virus and the new virus are almost exactly the same in their capacity to neutralize. So that's encouraging as far as it goes. There are more data coming through shortly, I think, on neutralization in the lab of these viruses by anti-sera induced by the vaccines. We're still waiting for those data. The modeling data suggests that we should expect these vaccines to continue to work well, even if not absolutely as well. But I have to say that there is more concern about some of the other variants, that particularly the South African variant and one of the two Brazilian variants, that these may to some degree escape the protection of the current vaccines. And people are tooling up already and preparing themselves for the possible need to reformulate vaccines to keep up with the viruses as they move forward. So there is a concern that this could be a problem, but there are solutions being planned.
So how straightforward is it? I'm certainly trivializing something that is challenging and complex, but how straightforward is it for the vaccine developers and manufacturers to reformulate against a novel strain? I mean, one of the benefits of the current models of vaccines and this new way of creating RNA vaccines is that there is that significantly shortened time frame to respond to a challenge in terms of manufacturing and design.
Yeah, the BioNTech team have more than once now quoted a time period of around 6 weeks for a reformulated mRNA vaccine. My sense is that the adenoviral vector vaccines might take slightly longer than that, which would mirror what we saw early 2020 in terms of how quickly these vaccines were brought through. Interestingly, the vaccines we're not yet got, but which we're developing whole virion vaccines, I've been also given a figure of around 6 weeks for reformulation. So I think the time period for producing new vaccines is quite quick, actually. But the unanswered question is exactly what regulatory steps would be required and how that could be expedited and what the requirements would be. I think we all expect it will be something similar to flu vaccine, which we do every year, but that will again be accelerated as we've seen up till now with COVID.
Right, so that's reassuring, but interesting that you raised this issue about the regulatory challenges and the idea that I know has been mooted in several fora that we may end up having an annual coronavirus vaccine just as we do a flu vaccine.
Yes, I think that's possible. I mean, it's very hard at this point to predict the future with confidence, but I think it's a strong possibility that we'll essentially learn to live with this virus. It will still, it'll adapt, it'll change. We will have to change with it, and then we'll have to live with it in the way we do with flu and other respiratory viruses.
So the program is now actually virtually in full swing. We're seeing thousands of people vaccinated across the UK. I'd be interested in your thoughts, Adam, on the progress of the vaccination program and any comments you have on the rollout strategy and its value.
Yeah, I mean, I think we benefit in this country from having a National Health Service that is essentially still centrally coordinated and funded. And we've also benefit from really quite good IT systems, which after many years of travel and difficulties seem to have come home to roost. So we've got a national register that's telling us and functioning who's had the vaccine, where, when, which vaccine, and that's linking up very nicely to the databases on COVID testing. And here in Bristol, we're linking it into admissions with hospitalization. So we are really well equipped to do this kind of program and coordinate it. In terms of the approach we're taking, again, we have a massive advantage because we can target the people, we can identify the people as well as target the people who are at highest risk. And that massively increases the impact. I've seen figures of numbers of vaccines needed to prevent a death of 1 in 20 care home residents, 1 in 160 people in their 80s. And if you go down into the adult population of healthy adults, it goes up to 1 in 47,000. So if you use the vaccines targeted this way, you can get much more impact out of them. And that's clearly the right way to do it. But many other countries are struggling to be able to do it the way we're doing it.
Again, that's not only interesting, but reassuring to hear. So do we have any insight yet on the longevity of protection? And I guess we sort of have to unpick that in the context of the strategy of going for as many as possible with the first vaccination and then following up with the second.
Yeah, so two different questions in there. So we, of course, don't really know about the longevity of the vaccine protection yet because the time hasn't gone by for us to be able to observe that or measure the immune responses. We are seeing protection, pretty reliable protection following infection of at least 6 months. So we could derive from that that maybe the vaccines can do as good, if not better. But of course, that does depend on the virus not changing and evading the responses the vaccines made. In terms of the dose delay thing, well, we're very rapidly going to get information on that right now here in Bristol. In fact, today we're collecting samples from people receiving their first dose of Pfizer. We'll be following them through the next 2 months and watching their antibody responses. And we're also looking at the protection vis-a-vis hospital admissions with pneumonia. So we're going to find out about that. But I think the important point to emphasize is that there's increasing evidence that delaying the second dose actually increases substantially your post-boost response and likely, therefore, with the duration of your protection. So I think actually, although people are worried about this delay, there may be an advantage in it, and it may be better in the longer term to have put that dose back a bit and got a bigger booster response when you receive it.
Yeah, of course, it's sort of paradoxical, isn't it, that if you're Pfizer or you're Oxford and AstraZeneca having to design a vaccine trial, you have to be very pragmatic about the time between the first and the second dose. And there's pressure on you, and of course, the whole system has to be manageable. But if you look at it from the perspective of an immunologist, there is, as you say, no reason to suspect that a delay would be adverse. In fact, quite the opposite, that there's good evidence that we might expect a stronger immune response by a delay.
Yeah, there's beginning to be that evidence. I think we've been under a lot of pressure as the policymaking group and the JCVI that we've made these recommendations without enough evidence to support it, particularly for the Pfizer vaccine. Well, that evidence is now arriving. And it is always difficult to make policy when there's limited evidence. But the models are really showing quite clearly that the approach we've taken is highly likely to have prevented more deaths and more hospitalizations. So I'm confident at this point, as I can be, that we're doing it the right way.
So I guess my final question to wrap up this podcast relates to looking to the future, where you've just described how we will learn more about the efficacy of the vaccines in general, and of course, about specific vaccines. I'm assuming that we don't enter an arms race immediately with the virus over mutations requiring the development of newly formulated vaccines, as we discussed earlier. If one vaccine proves to be superior to another, significantly so, is there any reason why someone that's received vaccine A might not be able to receive vaccine B were it to be demonstrated to be more effective?
Yeah, on the contrary, I think there's very little it's very hard to see a reason why that wouldn't be possible. But more importantly, because of supply issues, we do need to be able to be flexible. We may easily end up with people who've had a dose of one vaccine and then that vaccine's not available. So we're actually starting studies early February to look at this with the two vaccines that we've got available now, giving mixed schedules of one followed by the other both ways around, looking at the antibody response and the reactogenicity of that. I think we will add in other vaccines into that protocol as they come through so that we really know what works and what works best.
One almost feels guilty expressing this view because of the catastrophic way in which COVID has affected people's lives, killed many people, and is will have a profound effect on the economy and a profound effect on the world for many years to come. But in terms of thinking about the upsides, it's more than fascinating what we will learn with respect to vaccine science on so many levels, and have learned experientially in terms of the ways in which we've developed new systems to rapidly progress vaccine development and go through the necessary safety checks and processes in order to ensure that they can be rolled out safely, but with perhaps a greater speed than hitherto was possible or believed to be possible.
Yeah, I think in lots of areas we've discovered things are possible that we didn't think were possible before. I think perhaps the overwhelming message that's come through from many of my academic colleagues, not just working in vaccines, but in other areas around this pandemic, is that we've learned that although academic work is traditionally competitive, you know, when you collaborate, you could just get so much more done. And that both within Bristol, but also between centres in this country and across the world, we've just leapt forward because we're all helping each other out. And I think that's the big lesson to take forward into the future. Of course, an element of competition is good, but if that's what rules your life and gets in the way of progress, then it's no good.
Agreed. And of course, we're focused rightly on immunisation, vaccines, infectious disease. But there are other applications, and this technology will, I have no doubt, and the developments in this technology have significant implications for example, cancer immunotherapy in the future, if we're looking to the post-COVID world.
Yes, the BioNTech team were developing these vaccines precisely for that, for designer-made individual vaccines for cancer. And that's certainly their intention to go back to that. This will have taken an enormous leap forward in terms of the credibility of that approach. But I do agree that we're going to see immunotherapy moving outside purely infectious diseases.
Adam, I'm really grateful that you've spared the time to speak to us again today. And I should have said in the introduction, of course, that you are a key member of JCVI, the body that's making many of these crucial decisions about the vaccine strategy. So thank you for that, and thank you for your really important commitment of time and knowledge to that vital process to our, actually in effect, our national well-being. Really grateful to your time. Thank you very much.
Thanks, John. Always good to talk to you. Take care.